Hey everybody, and welcome back to Transgressive Music, and let's have another listen to the music of the wonderful Frank Zappa. By the way, let me change my glasses here, because these glasses here allow me to read much better. So today I want to have a listen with you from a very special album, the album One Size Fits All by Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention. Now, this album is being quite revered, at least that's my impression, so it would not be surprising if in many people's kind of personal top 10 lists of Frank Zappa's music, this would appear quite often on number one. It is a certainly an album that aged really well, and that over the time has accumulated quite a big fan base and a lot of people that are quite inspired by it and fascinated by it. And yeah, it's a record that has a lot to offer. So let's check out the first track on this album called Inca Roads. And after that, I can blather a little bit.
Someone build a place to leave a space. dead of vehicle bomb. I'm somewhere at the dead of vehicle bomb. Rather than the Indians first on the bill, carve up the hill.
A way to start a record. Not something you can hear every day, but it certainly wouldn't hurt for me to get a new reprinted copy of this record, because this is old as hell, and you can hear that crackling quite a lot. And it's one of those records that kind of goes along with you for decades. And I wasn't too kind to my records at the beginning as a young man, so they were not all in protective sleeves and stuff like that. Most of the time they were just some kind of flat surface you used to roll your joints and stuff like that. So some of my very old records are kind of banked up, and this is certainly one of them. So I cannot tell you much about the rhythmic structures in this track or song, because this is way over my head. But at the same time, it's still such an enjoyable song, and you can just go along with it and just accept it for what it is, outburst of creative energy and of musical intensity. And everyone in this quite amazing lineup is on top of his game. And of course, most of all, George Duke, who is not only playing the keyboards here, but as well singing. And I mean, he could play this live, the singing and the keyboard playing at the same time. And if you see some of the footage showing that, it's quite incredible. It only shows you what an incredible musician this is. And now, by the way, the topic of this song is basically a satirical handling of the topic of Paleo-Seti. Now, today this may sound like a bit of an odd topic for a song, but I'm old enough to remember what an incredible influence on the general society was the name of Erich von Däniken and his books about what in German language is being called Präastronautik, so basically Paleo-Seti, the hypothetical idea of extraterrestrial beings having visited our world thousands of years ago and maybe even being responsible for our own evolution and development, and leaving behind certain hints and traces and tracks of their existence within the ancient cultures, in this case the South American culture of the so-called Incas. And they of course have hilarious fun with it, but as a topic it's a brilliant opportunity for George Duke just to try some outlandish kind of space cosmic sounds. And I mean, this was 1975 and recorded probably mostly in 1974, and to squeeze this type of sound out of your synthesizers was pretty cool. And yeah, you have to really, pretty impressive. And of course, you have Frank Zappa playing guitar here, and I would say this is one of his really coolest solos he ever recorded. It's quite outstanding, and it's beautiful from beginning to the end, and it's inventive, it's quite exploratory, but in the right moments it's just really kind of laid back and cool and kind of a tongue in a cheek. So it's the type of solo that just smiles at you. Now the other important mention here must go to the goddess herself, Ruth Underwood. It's probably one of my favorite female musicians of all time. I mean, I'm constantly impressed by Ruth Underwood's work with Frank Zappa, and you can hear some of her vibraphone and marimba playing is just otherworldly. So here it's really a great track, great composition for her to shine. You have Chester Thompson on drums, outstanding drumming, together with Tom Fowler on bass. You have Napoleon Brock on flute, mostly, I think. There's a bit of saxophone playing, as far as I remember, but mostly I remember a flute. And I mean, they had Zappa, Brock and Duke, they had all these kind of intricate and totally weird vocal parts going on there. So this is a extremely complicated track, and it remains a mystery how you write something like that, and how you just keep up the creative energy just to develop a composition like this that is so intricate and at the same time completely mad in some parts. And it's probably the madness where you are challenged the most, because you just have to stay behind it, and you just have to believe that this is a good idea and that this will work later while you compose it. And I find it very impressive to lay down a composition like that that is completely outlandish, but of course in the end you listen to it and it's a beautiful array of ideas, and it's all brilliantly woven all together with this incredible lineup. So this is a really a great track, and it has humor. It's one of those few Zappa humorous tracks that are not entirely nasty. So it's kind of interesting topic, but again, in the mid 70s, people around the world were totally crazy, crazy about Erich von Däniken and the idea that we had been visited by aliens in the past, and that they may come back. And this was one of the most published author of his era, and which still pisses scientists off after 40 years. You still can encounter scientists that are completely angry over the fact that people were so gullible. But on the other hand, that's not entirely fair, because when I was a young kid, a teenager, I read a lot of books by Erich von Däniken, and there is just something fascinating about it, and it kind of fits with the mind of a young person that probably can't conform with the society around you, and it's probably a way of escapism to hope that there is something out there in space, and that there is something that's better than us, and maybe something that can redeem us or save us one day. And there's a certain degree of escapism, and there is always still the possibility that Erich von Däniken was right, but I don't see the gallery of proof being particularly strong in that department. It's all very hypothetical and kind of based on hints and ideas, but it never really manifests into something that could be acceptable as a proof. But it's not Frank Zappa's job to dwell on that. His job is kind of to reflect what the mood of the, what the zeitgeist around him was. And of course, he took big notice of all these books being read and sold in those years, particularly in those years, by this bestseller writer. And there are many others. It was not only, I mean, it was not only von Däniken. There was Robert Charroux and Charles Berlitz, and a lot of kind of fringe writers were just cooking their books about UFOs and stuff like that. And but it has a, again, I'm not entirely knocking it off, because there is something romantic about it that I certainly can understand, despite being quite convinced that in the end it's not a proper valid theory. But it's an extremely wonderful track, and one of the great Frank Zappa masterpieces, and people will be puzzled over this track in years to come. So I hope you've enjoyed that. And sorry, the record, the disc itself was not in the best quality. Actually, I was almost tempted to use the CD instead, but I think in the end it was okay. Anyway, let's move on, and thanks for visiting my channel, and hope to see you next time. And there are still some interesting Frank Zappa tracks in my plan for June, the month of Zappa, so to speak. And have a nice day. See you next time. Keep it spinning.